everybody. How are you? What have you been doing past week? I hope you're having fun. I hope you get to get fresh air. For me, I worked the whole week gardening. We have a big backyard and we dug all the ground. We leveled it up and we planted grass seeds. So I'm hoping to see grass come up. So are you ready for worship? Okay, let's pray. Dear Jesus, thank you for protecting us another week. Thank you for all the good things that you have given us past week. Our shelter, our food, our clothing, and our love from our families. And Lord, thank you most of all for being our God. Help us to worship you with one heart today, Lord, even though we're sitting at home. Help us to give you our full attention and our heart. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Okay, have your offerings ready? Okay.
Oh.
offering song. Joseph, can I ask you to collect offering? You can just put your hand in it.
We thank you for the way you provide for us. Please protect us during this dangerous event. Please continue to provide us with everything we need. We thank you for everything you've given us. Please use us to spread your message in the New Year's we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you very much. Okay, so our teacher Dave here has a couple of knock-knock jokes. You must be wondering why we're telling you knock-knock jokes, but there's a reason. You'll get to find out during the lesson, okay? All right, so here he comes, and see if you can get it.
So I have a couple knock-knock jokes. Knock-knock.
Who's there?
Hawaii.
Hawaii.
Hawaii, who?
I'm fine. How are you doing? Oh, that was lame. All right, next one. Knock-knock.
Who's there?
Tank.
Tank who?
You're welcome. Like, tank. Thanks, Tank.
Thank you.
All right, next one. Knock, knock.
Who's there?
Nobel.
Nobel who?
Nobel, that's why I knocked. There's no bell, so I knocked. Okay. All right, that's pretty lame.
That's it. Okay, I think I'll choose this one. I think knock-knock jokes are kind of silly, right? They are supposed to be silly. That was kind of a couple of the better ones, I think, that I found. Okay, so last week, who remembers what we learned last week? We learned about Peter. Remember, all along it was about Peter, and then it was about Apostle Paul. Now we're going back to Peter. Remember the vision of Peter? If you have your Bibles, turn to Acts chapter 12. But just to remind you of what happened before, remember that Peter was staying at a house, a guy's name was Simon the Tanner. And from there, he was seeing a vision, remember? And then he saw a vision to go to Caesarea, then a centurion was waiting for him, and then he stayed there a couple of days to tell him about Jesus. Remember all that? And then he came back to Judea. That's his, like, where all the Jewish people are, and all the new Christians too. So he came to Jerusalem area. So when we came to Jerusalem, some of the new Christians, that still the Jewish people, still the Israelites, they were saying, "Hey Peter," that's Peter right there. "Hey Peter, what are you doing? Why did you go all the way to Caesarea? We heard that you went to like Gentiles, people who are not even Israelite. You went to Gentiles' home and you ate with them and you slept there and you were spending so many days with them. You shouldn't be doing that. You're supposed to be one of us. They stick to one of us," right? Tell about Jesus to all these Jewish people, the Israelites, rather than going to the foreigners. And you call the foreigners Gentiles, right? They're not part of us. So Peter had to explain to them, no, I didn't mean to go there on my own will. It's because I went to Joppa and, you know, remember, in Joppa I was praying on the roof and I was hungry and I saw a vision. I saw a vision of a sheet that came from heaven and it was all filled with animals and reptiles and birds that are not clean, that God told us not to ever eat, but it came down in my vision and it said, the voice said, "Kill and eat." And I said, "Lord, I'm not going to eat that. You told us not to eat anything unclean. Those are unclean animals." And the voice from heaven said, "You cannot call anything that God created unclean." And the thing got lifted up and it happened three times. And lo and behold, you know, at the same time, people from Caesarea came and said a centurion was calling me, and then I went there, and the centurion also had the same vision of me coming to his house, and I knew that God wanted me to preach the gospel to Gentiles too. That's what happened. And when all the people heard him, heard Peter's testimony, this is what they said: "So then, even to the Gentiles, God has granted repentance that leads to life." So they were like, light came on. They should have known that. I don't know why they didn't know. Because when Jesus went up to heaven, he said, you know, tell the good news to the whole world, right? But they realized, okay, now we get it. Now the gospel of Jesus Christ, you know, meaning you repent of your sin and believe Jesus Christ as your Savior, that gospel is meant for Gentiles too, for everybody. And so they were happy and they said, "Okay, we get you, Peter. Okay, we understand that we gotta do this, right?" But something crazy happened, guys. You know, the king of Judea and Jerusalem at that time, his name was Herod. Herod just means king, actually. Herod, the grandfather, and then there's a son and the nephew and all that stuff. But the Herod at that time, this Herod, the king, he, guess what he did? He arrested one of Jesus' favorite disciples. Guess who would that be? So remember the four disciples of Jesus that Jesus always, there are 12, and four of them Jesus always had them with him, and they were Peter and, what's Peter's brother's name? Andrew, and then James and John. Remember the four of them? Peter, James, John, you know, they went on a sailboat. Remember that song we learned? Anyway, from those four guys, James got arrested. And his brothers, John, right? The sons of Zebedee, he got arrested, and guess what? Herod had him killed. James got killed. That's the first time that the disciples got killed, right? Before it was Stephen, but he was a deacon. So anyway, it was a shocking news for everybody. But when he did that, guess who were happy? Guess who were happy about James being killed? All the Jewish leaders, the Pharisees and Sadducees, the same guys who killed Jesus, right? Same people who were happy to kill Stephen. They were so happy. And those are the powerful people. Those are the rich people. And when they were like praising Herod, they were like looking up to him and like praising him. And that made Herod really, really happy and proud of himself and made him really feel powerful. He goes, "Oh, they like this. I think I'm going to arrest one more." Guess who they arrested? They arrested Peter. And he put him in prison. And he was going to make a grand entrance, meaning one day that he was going to pull him out in front of so many people and he was going to judge him and proclaim him guilty and have him killed too, so that so that the Pharisees and Sadducees will praise him more. He wanted all the attention, right? He wanted to become popular. So that's what happened. And when Peter was arrested and put in the jail, guess what all the Christians were doing? People who love Jesus, guess what they were doing? What does it look like they're doing? They're praying. The Bible says that so Peter was kept in prison, but the church was earnestly praying to God for him. The church, the Christians got together and they were earnestly praying. Who knows what earnestly mean? Earnestly, what does earnestly mean? It means with all your strength and all your mind, right? Very faithfully and with all your attention, like what you really, really, when you do it earnestly, right? With all your heart, and they were really, really praying hard for who? Peter. Oh God, please release Peter. Oh God, don't let Peter get killed just like James. We already lost James and it's so sad, and please don't let Peter get killed. And it was very realistic that it was going to happen because James got killed. And the way they kept Peter in prison, they had 16 people taking turns guarding, 4 people at a time. And two of the soldiers had him in the middle, had Peter in the middle with chains, like 2 sets of chains. And they were right next to him, one on left and right, and there were guards at the gates, right? All the way to the exit, right? And so they knew that there's no way Peter can get released. So they were praying earnestly. Have you ever prayed earnestly about somebody before in your lives? Mm-hmm. Earnestly? Have you ever? Well, who did you earnestly ever pray for?
My grandma.
Your grandma?
Because she had breast cancer, so then we had to pray.
Oh, that's right. Your grandma was really sick. She had cancer, and you prayed earnestly for her, right?
Yeah, not the one that comes to church. We lives in Taiwan.
Yeah, I know. Your auntie in Taiwan, yeah. And that's right. I remember that time, and I remember you asking for prayer. That's right. In similar way, because she's your family, right? Similar way, I remember when I was 12 years old, I prayed really earnestly for my mom and dad because they didn't know Jesus. And I was so scared that they would not go to heaven and that we would wind up in some other place. Like I would be in heaven because I love Jesus, but my parents don't love Jesus. So I was so afraid that they will not go to heaven. So I remember praying earnestly for me at the time. I was fasting, I wasn't eating food, sometimes 3 days, and praying long time, like 3 times a day, locking myself in a closet and praying for my mom and dad and crying because I was so afraid that my mom and dad would not make it to heaven, and asking people to pray for me, for my parents. So that was an earnest prayer, and I know you did that kind of prayer. So, you know, do you think God hears us when we pray earnestly?
Yes.
He does. It may not always work out the way we want it to, but that definitely God will do his will, right? So as they were praying earnestly, and that's our memory verse, guys. Let's try to quickly memorize this verse, okay? So can we read it together? So Peter was kept in prison, but the church was earnestly praying to God for him. Okay, can you try to memorize it? Okay, so we're going to say it 2 more times, and then I'm going to flip to the next screen so you don't see it. Okay, everybody has to do this, okay? You got to help me out because I may forget. Acts 12:5, okay? Ready to go? So Peter was kept in prison, but the church was earnestly praying to God for him. Okay, Acts 12:5. Maybe for me, if I go, so Peter was kept in prison, that's one phrase I can remember. Can you all say that? So Peter was kept in prison, but the church was earnestly praying to God for him. But the church was earnestly praying to God for him. Can we get it? Do you think you can get it? Okay, I'm going to go back to the screen for a test. Okay, ready, go. The address is X12Y.
So Peter was kept in prison.
But the church was earnestly praying to God for him. And what's the address again?
X12Y.
Okay, so they were, thank you. They were praying earnestly. Not crying out to God because they really didn't want him to get killed. And guess what? That night came when the king was, Herod was gonna, you know, make like grandiose entrance and have everybody just watch him say guilty to Peter and have him get killed, right? And become really popular. That night in prison, guess what happened? Peter is sitting between the two guards and he's falling asleep, right? And somebody pokes him in the shoulder. Actually, this is not the right picture. Somebody pokes him on the side and, hey, get up. And then he wakes up. And when he does that, when he gets startled, get up, after that hearing that word, the chains fell off. Just like that, the chains fell off. This is what the angel said. Let's read it together. Get up quickly. And then dress yourself and put on your sandals. Angel is giving him really good instruction, right? Dress yourself, meaning like maybe get your clothes together, put on your belt and wear your sandals, and then wrap your cloak around you and follow me. Said, get up, hurry up. And then he was able to, because somehow the soldiers, like they were like, they couldn't get up or their eyes were shut. I don't know what happened, right? God just blinded their eyes and ears and everything, and the angel let him out. But the Bible says Peter didn't know what was going on. He thought he was dreaming. He just couldn't, because the light and the angel in the room, he just thought he was in some kind of a dream or a trance or whatever. He just didn't think it was actually happening to him. Even when he was walking out, he didn't know what was happening to him. And then, as soon as they passed the gate, the locked door, the door just popped open. And he was able to get out. The angel led him out. Now, does it seem like something that's possible? The gates opening up, the lock popping open, the chains popping open. And the guards, there are so many of them that none of them can see him. Does it seem like something that, is it believable to you guys? You know what? I read a book a long time ago. It's called Heavenly Man, and you can look at it. You can buy and read the book. It's an amazing book. It's a book about a life of Paul Yuan. He's a Chinese man in China a long, long time ago. He met Jesus in a miraculous way. A lot of miracles happened to him because God chose him to be a servant. And he was put in prison for telling about Jesus to other people. This happened in China. And he was kept in such a very tight security place. And same thing happened to him. When you read his book, it's same as this one. The locks opened up and the guards, they were standing and they were like looking at him, but they couldn't really look at him. And he kept passing different doors and he was out of the prison building. That same thing happened. It's an amazing story. And soon as the angel led him out to the final gate outside of the building, the Bible says, immediately disappeared. Angel just like, disappeared, just like Philip was gone, right, to another place. And that's when he actually woke up. That's when he said, can we read this?
Now I know for sure that the Lord has sent his angel. He set me free from Herod's power.
He's like, oh, it was real. I wasn't dreaming. I'm really finally out of the door, out of the place, the prison. Where do you think he would go next? If you were Peter, where would you go? Back to the disciples. And Peter knew that most of the disciples were together in one place, and that's Mark. John the Mark, they call him. They call him John and Mark. And he's not one of the disciples, but he later writes the book of Mark. You know, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, right? They go to Mark's house, Mark's mom's house, and there the people were praying. That's the previous picture I showed you. They were praying earnestly. So he finds Mark's house, and guess what? He knocks on the door. It's nighttime, actually. He knocks on the door. That's why we told the knock-knock joke today. He knocks on the door, and later on, guess who comes to the door? Rhoda, a servant girl. At that time, a lot of people had servants, right? This girl, her name is Rhoda. She came to the gate, right? And she said, "Who is it?" And Peter said, "It's me, Peter. Open the door." And instead of opening the door, guess what she does? She's so shocked. She's so excited. She's so happy that she, instead of opening the door, she goes back inside to tell the disciples, hey, Peter's at the door. Peter's at the door. And they told her, "No, you're crazy. You're out of your mind." And she said, "Really, really, there's Peter at the door." And then they said, "You've just seen his angel, stupid." Probably said something like that. "You foolish girl, you don't know." And then she said, "No, really, really." But then, "Open the door." Because you have to be really quiet because the soldiers are going to come, right? And then they finally went to the door, and it was Peter. They said, "Peter, what happened? How did you get out?" Isn't it funny when you pray earnestly and God answers and miracle happens and you go, "Wait, how did that happen?" Right? We always have to remember to give God the credit. Say somebody's sick, right? And you pray that that person will not die. And if that person lives, you forget to say thank you to God. You say, "Oh, that was a very good doctor," or "That was a really good medicine. Next time you go to that hospital, okay, because they have the best doctors." And we forget that God answered the prayer, right? Anyway, we gotta remember that, because we are imperfect people, right? So we always have to remember to put God first, whatever happens. And then he goes, and they were all shouting, "Oh, praise God!" And then Peter said, "Shh, don't tell anybody. I mean, don't speak so loud," he said. "And I want you to tell James and other disciples that I'm alive." James? We thought James was dead. So this is not the James, one of the disciples. When Peter said, "Go tell James," it's Jesus' brother. Remember Mary and Joseph? They had other kids besides Jesus later on, and one of them's name is James. So James also writes the Bible later, right? Some of the books. So he says, "Go tell James," because apparently James became a very good disciple of Jesus. Before he wasn't. So he says, "Go tell James and tell other people, I must leave you. I need to go in hiding because they're coming after me," right? So he leaves them. And that's how God protects, right, Peter. And everybody's amazed. Do you think these people are scared now? No, they are encouraged, because Peter says, "Go tell," meaning, you know, don't be scared anymore. Don't be discouraged. God is watching over us. Many times I read a part in the book of Psalm yesterday, that even though God is almighty and he's so powerful, he's way, 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 way up there, he looks at the lonely people. Lowly people. We are the lowly people. He sees all of us and all our actions. And even though you may think God is so far, far, far away, God can see everyone who does evil action. Yeah? God watches the evil people. God watches the good people. He blesses and then he punishes. Well, same thing with Herod. Herod was the one who had devised this evil plot so that he can become popular, right? So guess what happens to Herod after a couple of days? Oh, sorry. Before that, Herod finds out, "Hey, what happened? Take out Peter. Bring him out." And then the soldiers come and says, "Oh, Peter's gone. He's not in there anymore." "What do you mean? he's not in the prison. What were you doing? And so we don't know. We were there. We weren't falling asleep, but he's gone. And then he said, investigate. And after they investigated, you know, there was no answer. They couldn't find Peter. So guess what Herod did to the soldiers? He killed them all. You know why? Because by the rule, the law was that if a soldier loses a prisoner, you have to pay back with your own life. So he orders for the soldiers to be killed. And then he still wanted to be popular and famous. There was one part, it's a long story, he goes to another place and everybody's worshiping. Oh, your voice is like God's voice, some people said, because they wanted some things from him. And he didn't say, no, I am not God. God is way up there, you know, he's God and I'm just a person. He didn't say that. He became so proud that he just like let people shower him with all these acclamation, right? Meaning lifting him, honoring him, and then he just like enjoyed the attention. Yeah, we have to be careful that we don't become proud of ourselves. Every time people give us an applause, we have to say, by God's grace, it was God who did it, right? Instead of just like, oh, accepting it. Because when he did that, guess what happened? He dropped dead. The Bible says he just dropped dead and he just died right at that instant, right? And so that was end of King Herod, this particular King Herod. I got his name, actually. Agrippa. Herod Agrippa, that's his name. So that's how he died. Next phrase. But still, guess what happened? Let's read that together. But what happened after? Ready, go? But God's word continued to spread, and many people believed the message. The Bible says, after Herod died, you know, the Bible, the gospel message kept on spreading all over. And then we'll also learn that we're going to talk about Paul and how Paul plays a very big role in spreading the gospel to the rest of the world. Okay. So that's what makes us happy, right? It makes us happy when we do God's will. And I'm sure Peter and the disciples were happy to see God's will being done. You know the word joy, guys, right? How do you spell joy? J-O-Y. When are you joy the most? When are you happiest the most? And it's an acronym. J, if you put Jesus first in your life. O, if then you put other people second. And Y, when you put yourself last. Doesn't mean you don't love yourself. You gotta love yourself too. But you always have to put Jesus first. Doesn't matter, no matter if you want to go that way, you always have to say, what does God want me to do? If he tells you to go that way, you have to, right? And then you have to also think of other people. If I do this, what will happen to the other person? Is that person going to get harmed? Or is that person going to lose out because I put myself first? So you always have to think of other people. Okay, and then you put yourself last. That's becoming humbling. Yeah, even you humble yourself, that is the true joy, guys. Yeah, look at Peter. Peter put God's word first, then he thought of other people, then he just like thought of himself last, right? When God told him to go to Caesarea and tell about Jesus, he didn't say, I'm not going, I don't go to a non-Jewish people. He did. Yeah, he put other people second, and then he put his self last. So I want you to remember the next week, the whole week that we're not gonna be meeting you again. I want you to practice doing joy, right? When you pray, how do you do joy when you're praying? When you pray about Jesus first, right? When you start to pray, you don't say, "Dear God, I want this, I want this, I want this, I want this. Please help me with this, 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 this." Instead of doing that, Oh God, thank you for your love, just like Joseph prayed today. Thank you for protecting us. You're amazing, God. You saved us from our sins. Thank you for all the things that Jesus has done for us. Thank you for encouraging me. Thank you for blessing our family. Thank you for giving us everything that you have given us. And you are an awesome God. You praise God. You put Jesus first. And then you pray for other people. Instead of saying, me, 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 I want this and that. You pray for your family, your friends, the church. Please pray for the church, okay? And your country and the president, yeah? Then you pray for yourself. God, can you give me wisdom? God, when school starts again, can you help me to be wise? And can you help me to be helpful to other people? Yeah, that's how. So I want you to do that. So I wrote all that. When you're eating, playing, sharing about Jesus, whatever it is put Jesus first, others second, and yourself last. Okay, so I think that's that. Okay, and let's finish with a quick prayer and a Lord's Prayer, okay? Dear Jesus, thank you for teaching us about Peter. Thank you that Peter always did your will and he put himself last. He even went to the prison, Lord, and you rescued him. You taught us that when people earnestly pray, that you answer our prayers, and we're thankful that you are such a living God, that you always see things and you always hear us and always answer our prayers. So we thank you. Help us to remember that for the rest of the week. Help us to remember J-O-Y. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Okay, let's all sing the Lord's Prayer, everyone. Ready, go.
Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Forever and ever. Amen.
Okay. Joseph, can you stand here, please? Skylar, can you, because you're brother and sister, you can stand next to each other. Can you say goodbye to everybody? Just look at the screen and say goodbye, everyone. Ready? Goodbye, everyone. Bye. See you next time. Bye-bye.